In 2017, students submitted over 10.2 million college applications in the United States, with almost 17 million enrolled as undergraduate students. The process of making a college list, building a resume filled with extracurriculars, writing essays, and submitting an application has become a common rite of passage for many high schoolers around the country. However, the onset of the COVID-19 pandemic has changed the college admissions process not only for the class of 2021, but for all future applicants. Recently, many colleges have closed their campuses, meaning that prospective students don't have the opportunity to experience an in-person tour or get a feeling of what it's like to attend the university.
So it's all either virtual through meeting the representative, or you have to do a virtual tour on their website. You're not really getting a feel of the school. You're not really going there to see what they have.
Another big change to this year's college admissions process is standardized testing. In 2018, over 2 million students took the SAT. This year, due to COVID-19, testing centers have had to close or limit their capacity, prohibiting many students from taking either the ACT or the SAT. While both organizations have done their best to expand testing dates and locations, the health concerns of many students still prevent them from taking the test.
In some of the most affected areas, we created pop-up test sites. And what we meant by that was we worked with either hotels or local community centers to create a pop-up site. So that way, if our regular test centers were not comfortable opening and they made the decision to close, we could still offer a testing opportunity in those areas that were most affected.
The truth is that there's no test score that's worth risking a human life, either the lives of teenage test takers or of the adults, the teachers and guidance counselors and school staff who would have to proctor the test.
Our current admission system, with test scores, GPAs, and ideally long list of extracurriculars, has started to change, both positively and negatively.
With the pandemic, with the racial unrest that we've had in our country and continue to have, I think it really has accelerated, in a good way, accelerated this conversation about what should we be looking at in college admissions.
First, many studies have shown that a student's standardized test scores are more representative of the student's socioeconomic class over their intelligence or likelihood of succeeding in college, compared to high school GPA, which has been shown to be a much more accurate predictor.
There's a stronger correlation between SAT scores and family income than there is between SAT scores and first year grades.
A lot of the times what the history has shown with standardized testing, like the SAT and ACT, are that it's not showcasing the strengths of students of color. There's always been somewhat of a disparity there.
But the test is not supposed to be a measure of looking backward and seeing who had opportunity. It's supposed to be a predictor looking forward, forecasting who can succeed in college. And it does a poor job of that.
Several colleges have decided to go either test optional or test blind. Test optional schools allow applicants to decide whether or whether not to submit their test scores, while test blind schools do not look at any of their applicants' scores.
We chose to go test optional last year. We had been looking at it for a couple years, actually, so we'd done a lot of research to see how at McAllister test scores that we've been receiving actually predict academic success at McAllister, and we've seen that for the most part, it's not all that predictive.
A lot of schools, even across the United States, have decided to be test optional for this application season and this admissions process, just because they know a lot of the tests were canceled in the summertime, and they know they're still being canceled now, so they don't want to add that stress on to students.
Prior to the pandemic, say at the beginning of March of 2020, there are about 1,070 four-year schools that were test optional, and one, Hampshire College, that was test blind. In the intervening now 7 months, another 550 colleges have dropped their admissions testing requirements, and about 60 more have gone completely test blind.
Beyond adding a level of stress to students who are taking the test, the value placed on scores can deter otherwise capable applicants who would have been a good fit for the university.
You know, for us, a big reason we were looking at that in the first place was so that we could, be a more accessible and inclusive place.
in general, schools that go test optional get a broader range of applications. They get more academic talent in their applicant pool, and they get more diversity of all sorts. It enriches the applicant pool in many ways, simply by taking down that barrier.
On the other hand, some might say taking away test scores might further imbalance the playing field, as the attention will turn to the number of AP courses a student has, the number of high-profile awards they might have received, number of leadership positions, or how many community service organizations they're a member of.
Where a student might not have the best GPA or might not have access to rigorous courses, just by maybe it's an urban school or a rural school that doesn't provide that, and the ACT can really help paint that larger picture and give a better predictability of where that student can be successful. But our research, as well as other research, shows that when you mix multiple measures like GPA and a college entrance exam, the ability to predict whether a student will be successful increases greatly.
Even so, the test makers have continued to defend their college entrance exams despite claims of inequity.
I see ACT, ACT sees us not as, we aren't showing inequities. The ACT is not biased in any way, shape, or form. What the ACT is showing is that there are educational inadequacies in our socioeconomic status of our students.
In either scenario, it is important that universities take into account both the benefits and detriments of using standardized testing scores as part of their application for both students and the school itself. Shifting away from this traditional system of admissions forces colleges to use new creative ways to get to know students.
Beyond that are a host of non-cognitive factors, non-academic factors, and the University of Maryland has been a leader in researching this kind of stuff, that self-discipline, drive, ability to work with others, creativity, none of those are measured by standardized tests. But they are demonstrated in many ways by what a person has done outside the classroom.
Other schools have conducted interviews with students over Zoom or asked students to create short videos of themselves answering different questions.
In terms of grades, though they're a better predictor than the test, even better would be a portfolio of the work that a student has done in high school. There are a number of groups experimenting with that kind of information. Trying to figure out technology ways to collect that and make it available to information offices.
Mastery Transcript Consortium is an organization that partners with high schools looking to reimagine how they grade and assess students.
The last few years, we have worked to co-develop the Mastery Transcript with our member schools. So this interactive transcript that we've created with them is really a response to the needs and requests of schools that are looking to do teaching and learning very differently.
Mastery Transcripts break down skills and content matter that the students have mastered instead of just listing GPA and grades. They also give descriptions of these skills and samples of the students' work.
And so really what was necessary and what is necessary is this interactive transcript that really reflects the full scope, not just the academic, but the social, emotional, and behavioral supports of students, but also be able to send that as a communication piece, as a story to colleges and universities and employers and others to say, this is all that I've done, and this is what I'm capable of doing, this is what I'm passionate about. The long-term effects of COVID, from my vantage point, is that colleges and high schools will take the time to really listen to their students, listen to their communities, and find better ways of engaging and honoring where our students come from.
While concerns about standardized testing and the college admissions process have always been there, COVID-19 has pushed many institutions to explore new options when it comes to accepting a broader range of students and understanding what they can bring to the school beyond the statistics. As colleges and applicants face new challenges, they also have new opportunities to reevaluate the college admissions process and the ways we can make it more equitable for all students.